These images suggest a time when everything was rosy and problems were trivial. In fact, the levels of control we have today are much greater, and we're much more careful about people's health and the environment in which we live. In terms of the use of water, for example, things used to be very lax. For over 100 years, there were local bylaws designed to protect water as a resource. They were made locally and applied only in their own particular area. The Water Act of 1945 changed that. But it wasn't until 1987 that standardization began. From then, bylaws had to be based on the government's model, approved by the government, and renewed every 10 years. Today, they've been totally replaced by the Water Supply Water Fittings Regulations 1999, which were implemented on the 1st of July 1999. These new national regulations are an important advance and govern the control of water supply installations in England and Wales. They apply to every installation that is supplied from a public main by a water undertaker. They're designed to prevent waste, undue consumption, misuse, contamination of water, and erroneous measurement. There's a voluntary approval scheme which will allow approved installers to carry out their own inspections and self-certify their installation work without having to involve inspectors. It'll be run by the water supply industry and based on a national guidance framework set out by the Water Regulations Advisory Scheme, or RAS. This BPEC training course, with its assessment component and eventual certification, will take you through everything you need to know and prepare you for acceptance by water companies as an approved contractor. To complete our general survey of the regulations, let's go back to the various changes that have contributed to them. The main legislation concerning water regulations is the Water Industry Act 1991. More recently, of course, we've had to take account of European law. We now need EC approval of any technical regulations, and this has meant making changes in some of our water installations. Conservation is crucial, and the new regulations help to rationalise water use. They're also much tighter on the use of backflow preventers to stop possible contamination. The most obvious examples of the changes are pressure flushing valves for WCs and urinals and valve type WC cisterns, which are permitted from 2001 and mark a significant departure from previous practices. As listed in your manual, certain types of work require you to give notification of your intentions to the water supplier and wait until their consent has been given for you to start. Notifications needed for a wide range of jobs, from erecting a building or altering fittings on any premises other than a house, to installing bidets, particular types of shower units, ponds and swimming pools. You can consult the full list in your manual. The regulations overall contain many changes, and you'll need to know more or less everything that's in them. Here, though, we'll just outline what they consist of. Part 1. The preliminary section says when they take effect and how they should be applied. It also offers definitions of terms to make understanding easier. Some are complex, others seemingly simple, such as a dwelling, an institution, or a public building. Part 2 covers requirements. It sets out what is expected of individuals installing water fittings and how they should be installed to prevent waste or contamination. It also places conditions on the materials and fittings that you can use. In Part 2, Regulation 4, the Schedule of Requirements for Water Fittings, deals with the more practical aspects of the regulations. This is the most important section for us. It notes the 34 separate requirements covering all aspects of the use of water fittings and provides the material for much of this course. Part 3 concerns enforcement, it lists penalties for contravening the regulations and dispute procedures. Remember, in law, the burden of proof is with you, the installer. You must be able to prove that your installation complies with the requirements of the regulations. And to do that, you need to be familiar with them. First then, let's consider the regulations concerning the materials you use. Materials include all metallic and non-metallic substances, including plastics, used in the manufacture of pipes, fittings and appliances, as well as those used for jointing and protective coatings. Their basic aim is simple. Anything you use which can come into contact with water mustn't affect its quality, contaminate it in any way that affects its drinking qualities, or contain any substances that might leach into the water, react with it, make it toxic, biologically unhealthy, or affect its colour, taste, temperature, or smell. Of course, the manufacturers of all the materials you use are also responsible for meeting the regulations, and most of them take that responsibility seriously. But you can't just rely on them. It's your responsibility to know which materials you can use. You're the installer, and if any harmful substance was installed, you'd be the one who was prosecuted, not the manufacturer. The easiest way to check is to consult the current Fittings and Materials Directory compiled by the Water Regulations Advisory Scheme. There's plenty of guidance in your manuals and in the labels attached to substances and compounds. Basically, there are several things that can affect materials: internal and external temperature, corrosion, the compatibility of metals, aging, fatigue, durability, and permeability. When designing and installing a system, you have to take them all into account. Supply and distributing pipes supplying water to separate premises must all be fitted with stop valves. There are several types suitable for the job, and you can check them in your manual. The valve must be fitted on the supply pipe inside the premises, above floor level, and as near as possible to the point of entry. It must be able to control the supply to the whole premises without cutting off the supply to any other premises. Normally, separate premises will each have their own supply pipe. But whatever the design, it's essential to fit a stop valve in every house, flat, shop, factory, office, or other premises that's occupied separately. When you're designing an installation, you can get guidelines on the regulations from the local water supplier. The first thing to consider is the location. Always avoid locations where there could be any risk of contamination or damage to pipework, for example, sewers, drains, cesspools, or manholes. Remember too the importance of installing cold water pipes in places where they will not be warmed above 25 degrees centigrade. If they are, there's a risk of bacterial growth, especially Legionella. Fit stop valves to supply and distributing pipes so that separate premises have their own isolation points. And position draining taps so that when an individual system has to be drained down for maintenance or repair, the amount of water wasted is minimized. Visual inspection, disinfection, flushing, soundness and performance testing, and making final checks before handing over are all part of normal good working practice. The water regulations, though, only cover things that might affect the quality of water or lead to it being wasted. That means disinfection, soundness testing, and flushing. They also cover workmanlike manner. Flushing may seem straightforward enough, but it's important to note that the regulations are very strict about it. Every water fitting in a new installation, or when there's been alterations, extensions, or maintenance to an existing system, must be thoroughly flushed. And that means every single valve, tap, cylinder, cistern, boiler, or whatever else is part of the system. After flushing, many systems have to be disinfected. They're listed in your manual. This work must be carried out by a suitably qualified person to the relevant standard BS6700 or by following the local water undertaker's guidelines. To test for soundness, you first check that jointing's complete and that pipes and components are properly secured. Look for any signs of leakage or problems. Then open all valves in the installation. Fill the installation with drinking water, letting all the air in it escape. Allow half an hour for the water pressure to stabilize. Then check the system and joints again for leakage. Now pump the pressure up to 1.5 times working pressure and leave it for 1 hour. There should be no leakage or loss of pressure. If there is, find it, repair it, and repeat the test. There are different procedures for flexible or elastomeric pipes. You'll find them in your manual. Always do interim tests before you cover up any work. That'll not only confirm that your work is sound, it'll show the client that the work's progressing satisfactorily. The test covered by the regulations is the final test, which is generally carried out immediately before the handover date. It's important to make sure that there are no cross connections between wholesome and unwholesome water. It's interesting that the regulation specifically identifies rainwater, recycled water, or any fluid other than water supplied by the undertaker as categories of unwholesome water. It's probable that more and more use will be made of recycled water in future, so the possibility of cross-connection and backflow will increase correspondingly. You'll find the different types of water listed in your manual, which also tells you how they should be connected. In order to identify them, there's a system of color coding which is used in larger and industrial buildings, but would also be useful in houses or other small buildings which use water other than that supplied by the undertaker. This is a cold water supply pipe. This one's for cold water distribution. It's drinking water and distributing pipes that we need to protect. It should also be clear at drawing off points what sort of water they provide. And accurate layout diagrams will show the customer where the various pipes are, both in the building and below ground. The solution to the problem is simple. Once you've identified a potential hazard, make sure that you avoid it when you're connecting up pipes. The diagrams in your manual illustrate good and bad practice. Remember, never connect supply and distributing pipes together, even though they're both supplying drinking water. If you must, as in shower mixers, fit a backflow device. In these and other examples we've given of where it's important to prevent contamination of wholesome water, we've used the term backflow prevention. This simply means stopping water flowing in the opposite direction to that which was intended. It can be caused in two ways. First, back pressure, which is when there's an increase in pressure somewhere in the system. In this case, it's water expanding from an unvented hot water heater and flowing back into the supply pipe. The other cause is back siphonage. In this case, there's been a break in the main supply, which has siphoned the water back from the hose pipe towards the main. There are many different types of backflow prevention device to deal with such situations and prevent contamination. Which one you use depends on the particular pipework situation and other factors. The different types and preferred combinations are listed in your manual and in tables in the regulations. To decide which device to use, you must first assess the risk. Up to now, we've been used to dealing with 3 categories of backflow risk, but in the new water regulations, there are 5 fluid categories to assess. They represent various qualities of water depending on how drinkable they are or how dangerous they might be to health. Each category calls for a different device. Again, check your manual. You'll come across the expressions whole site protection and zone protection. The first is a means of protecting one property from the possibility of backflow from another. The second is a way of preventing backflow from one part of a property to another part. Connections to sanitary appliances pose special problems. The main issue concerns submerged inlets to baths, wash basins and sinks, which are Category 3 risk. The normal protection is the air gap between the tap and the appliance's spillover. Some appliance designs prevent this gap being maintained, and so there's a risk of backflow. In this case, each tap has to be fitted with an alternative form of backflow prevention. Perhaps one of the main differences in the new regulations is that between the old and new requirements for WCs. With effect from January 1, 2001, it's permissible to use a pressure flushing system or supply bowls using manually operated flushing valves direct from the supply pipe. It means that any manually operated flushing valve must be above the WC pan and discharge through or incorporate a pipe interrupter with a permanent atmospheric vent. An alternative means of flushing is the familiar flushing system, either using a siphonic flush or a flushing valve as shown, like those preferred elsewhere in Europe. A tap fitted in a backyard is a good example of how the whole backflow prevention process works. Under the new regulations, you must fit backflow protection for every tap that has a hose union connection. If it doesn't, even if it's outside like this one, no preventer is needed. But this is where risk assessment comes in. You have to ask what the tap's going to be used for. If it's just going to fill buckets, there's no problem. But if a hose is to be fitted, different considerations apply. Remember, there are always different requirements for different locations, and domestic, industrial and commercial premises have distinct regulations. You've got to be familiar with the basic regulatory requirements concerning the supply of cold water to premises of all sorts. Each establishment must have at least one drinking water tap, which is supplied either directly from the supply pipe, from a pump delivery pipe that draws water from a supply pipe, or from a distributing pipe supplied from a protected storage system. In larger, more complex buildings, you'll need to provide drinking water in several different locations, such as common landings, staff rooms, or in or near toilet facilities. In these buildings, there may also be places where the pressures needed to supply the water are higher than that of the normal supply pressure. In such cases, water may need to be pumped. If so, a brake system must be fitted to act as backflow protection. And if a tap draws drinking water from a cold water storage system, the system must also be protected from contamination. Cisterns are familiar, relatively simple objects, and yet they come in all shapes, sizes, and configurations, depending on capacity, location, function, and various other considerations. To see their complexity, check your manual. Basically, these are their main features. The supply arrives from the mains, and there's a servicing valve near the inlet point. A float-operated valve or some equivalent device inside the cistern regulates the flow. There's a screened overflow pipe and a screened vent at the top. And the water is distributed through a pipe at the bottom, which is also fitted with a servicing valve, reasonably close to the cistern. The cover on top of the cistern is tight-fitting to keep out light, dust and insects. There's sufficient room above it to remove it and get access to the cistern when necessary for inspection and cleaning. The cistern and pipes are insulated and adequately supported. And of course, all the materials involved are corrosion-resistant, watertight and fit for the purpose. The regulations concerning hot water services requirements concentrate on two things: preventing water being wasted and providing a degree of safety to the building and the people living in it. They look at hot water expansion and how to contain and control it in vented and unvented systems. They deal with safety devices to control water temperature in storage heaters and temperature relief valves through which hot water is discharged. As with most other aspects of your course, there are many different considerations according to the type of installation involved. For more detailed information, consult your manuals. All hot water which expands in unvented water heaters or hot water systems must be contained within the system and not run to waste. This needs two levels of control. First, an expansion vessel connected to the supply pipe near the inlet, which can hold at least 4% of the total volume. As the water expands, it flows into the vessel, then returns to the system as it cools. In this system, the expansion unit is inside the hot water heater as an integral part of the fitting. And second, because expansion vessels and units can fail, there has to be an expansion relief valve. The regulations set an upper limit of 100 degrees centigrade on the temperature of water in secondary hot water vessels, which means that vent pipes, temperature control devices, safety devices, or dedicated cold water storage systems have to be fitted. To comply with the regulations, there are three levels of temperature control. First, a cylinder or immersion heater thermostat. Then, a non-self-resetting thermal cutoff device, which shuts off the energy supply at a predetermined temperature. And finally, in case these controls both fail, there's a temperature relief valve which must be easily visible and discharged to a safe place. These devices prevent this happening. If the hot water storage vessel in a vented system overheats and boils, the excess heat is dissipated through the vents. The water level in the system must be low enough to allow room for expansion. The amount to be allowed for is 4% of the volume of water contained in the secondary hot water system. One last point in this section concerns closed primary circuits. To make sure that there's no possibility of contamination from backflow between the circuit and a supply or distributing pipe, there must be no permanent connection between the two. Any temporary connections used to fill the circuit must be disconnected immediately afterwards. WCs and urinals use large quantities of water. Among other things, the new regulations are designed to reduce wastage, so their biggest impact on installers is likely to be in this area. We've already mentioned the fact that drop valve mechanisms are allowed from 2001, as well as the familiar siphon ones. Another innovation is manually operated flushing valves for WCs and urinals, again allowed from 2001. They can be fed from either the supply pipe or the distributing pipe. In premises other than a house, they can also be flushed by a manually operated valve from the main supply or storage with a flow rate of no less than 1.2 litres per second. In each case, there must be suitable backflow prevention. There's a lot of variety in the types of systems that can be fitted in different circumstances and locations. Once again, check your manual to make sure you know all the variations. Warning pipes, or overflows as they're more commonly called, must always be fitted to flushing systems or troughs. There are stipulations about their size, and they must be sited where it's easy for the property owner to see them. Normally, that means they terminate outside the building. You can fit a common warning pipe like this, but it must only serve WCs and they must all be at the same level. Each WC must have an individual pipe which discharges into a tun dish which is easily visible. It's also possible to have arrangements whereby the warning pipe discharges into the pan or the flush pipe. Again, though, it must be easily visible, and for the discharge into the pan, there must be a minimum gap of 150 millimetres which makes it rather an awkward configuration. Urinals can be flushed manually or automatically from either a cistern or a flushing valve. The regulations list the maximum amounts of water permitted for these operations, depending on the type of cistern, supply pipe, or distributing pipe, and the number of urinals being served by it. To save water, urinals should only flush when they're being used, so there are various devices to regulate water flow, including time control, photoelectric cells, pressure pads, hydraulic flow, or just manual operation using chain pulls and siphons. Under the regulations, every bath, wash basin, sink, and other similar appliance must have a watertight, accessible plug fitted to its waste outlet. The normal type of plug on a chain is fine. So too is a lever-operated plug, but in that case, there must be no connection made between the tap water and the waste fitting. There are some exceptions made, for example, in the case of appliances with water-saving spray taps and drinking water fountains. Pumped shower installations use much more water than the gravity-fed ones, and shower units with multiple water outlets must be notified to the water supplier. There's no change to the method of connecting washing machines, dishwashers, or other appliances, except those relating to the maximum quantities of water they should use and the need for backflow prevention. Finally, let's quickly consider the regulations concerning water use outside. Drinking troughs for animals and poultry must be fitted with a float-operated valve or some other effective shut-off device. They must also be protected from mechanical damage and the risk of backflow. Ponds, fountains, and pools must be made watertight with some sort of impervious lining and not connected directly to any supply pipe or distributing pipe. And we've already covered outside taps. This has just been an overview of some of the things that you need to know. There's a lot to remember and plenty of variations, subsections, and exceptions to the regulations. Basically, though, they're there to help us conserve water and make it safe for use by the public. The onus is on you to make sure that the systems you install meet all the requirements. You'll find all the details you need in your course manuals. Good luck.